glorious miracles in your life. What am I talking about? Well, let me not get ahead of myself, but let me just preface this message by saying that the Lord spoke to my heart, and he just, as preparation was taking place for this week, he said, we have arrived to a season of the supernatural.
Wow.
How many would dare to believe that?
Amen.
Yeah. How many would like to see a season of the supernatural?
Hallelujah. Yeah.
Whether it's a personal miracle you need from God, whether it's a relational thing that you have that you are lacking, whether it's a family issue, whether it's a financial or a health issue or some other type of issue, how many would like to see the supernatural of God released on your natural?
Hallelujah.
The other thing that the Lord spoke to me, I felt like he said, remember that December is a month of the miraculous.
Yeah.
How many understand that to be true? When we consider all of December, and I'm not talking about Santa.
Come on. Amen.
I'm not talking about the reindeer.
That's right.
I'm not talking about everything that the world has done to commercialize and secularize a holiday that really is a holy day. Come on, somebody.
Amen.
But I am talking about what this month of December represents. And before we even were to consider the supernatural birth of Jesus Christ, we're going to talk about what this week represents. I felt like the Lord also spoke to my spirit. He said, you're in weeks of the wonderful. Somebody say weeks. Of the wonderful. How many want to see the supernatural, the miraculous, and the wonderful take place in your life?
Amen.
And I sense that the Lord spoke to me about that because he pointed out to me something in Scripture that many people may have never made the connection on, or they have forgotten about the connection. Mm. So what am I talking about? Well, consider that when we read first from which chapter?
10.
John chapter 10. And then we read from chapter
11.
And chapter 11 is a powerful, supernatural, miracles, wonderful chapter. When we consider the resurrection of Lazarus, how many can say amen to that?
Amen.
And yet, what's interesting is that we have to remember that God is a God of order. Somebody say order.
Order.
And before 11 comes, what came before 11?
10.
10. And what a lot of people don't remember or have not been taught is that when the scriptures were written, these letters, these books that we study, they didn't originally have numbers to distinguish chapters. They didn't have numbers to distinguish verses. And so they were literally just ongoing letters. And so many times when we look at a chapter and it comes to an end in our Bibles, and then we pick up on the next chapter, if we're not careful, we segment what has happened in the flow of Scripture. And if we're not careful, then we say, okay, this chapter was for this time, and that chapter was for another time. And we have to understand that the Scripture is whole in its context. And if we're going to understand what happened in chapter 11, we should make sure we know what happened in chapter 10. And when we look at chapter 10, we read in verse 22 that now, somebody say now. It said that it was a certain feast, and it was the feast of what? Dedication. And many people have not made the connection that that feast of dedication is indeed what is called. See, a lot of Pentecostals, we grew up in an era where there was some erroneous teaching called replacement theology. And replacement theology basically taught that God no longer had a covenant with Israel, that his covenant with Israel was replaced now with a covenant with the Gentile church. And so therefore, we put out the Jewish teachings and the traditions and those statutes and precepts that God established in Old Testament scripture. And we don't realize that Jesus did not come to abolish the law, but he came to fulfill the law. Come on, somebody.
Amen.
And Jesus himself right here is actually going to Jerusalem to celebrate the Feast of Dedication, otherwise known as the Feast or festival of lights, otherwise known as
Hanukkah.
But some people don't even know what Hanukkah is. See, to study Hanukkah, you can just do some Googling. You're going to come across what was written in a book that is not part of the Holy Canon, but the Book of Maccabees. And what you'll find is that somewhere around 160s before Jesus Christ, there was a ruler of the Syrian Empire that had desecrated the temple of God. They brought in their false gods into the temple, and they erected one such statue and altar unto the goddess Zeus. And then they started offering sacrifices in the temple of God unto this god Zeus, and they even sacrificed the most unclean animal in scripture, which is the pig. When that happened, there was a priest who rose up with a righteous indignation, with a holy anger, and he said, this is not right. His name was Mattathias, and he said, we've got to stand up. We can't allow idolatry in the temple. We can't allow false worship in the house of God. We've got to clean house, and I thank God that he didn't do it alone. He had five sons. How many are thankful for generational ministry? And one of those sons was Judah. And Judah, whose name Praise, he says, no. We're going to restore the praise up in here. And so he rose up with others. And when he did, they came against the false gods. They tore down the idols. They tore down the altars. They took out the false sacrifices. And they rededicated the temple. Now, what's interesting is to rededicate or to reconsecrate, in Hebrew, you call that Hanukkah. See, some people think that Hanukkah is something that we shouldn't be conscious of. But my friends, we need to be very conscious of it. Because what was happening in those times was that the temple had been desecrated. There was idolatry in the house of God. And God said, oh, no, you don't. This is my house. Zeal for your house has consumed me. And he cleaned house. And he said, we're going to rededicate this temple. We're going to reconsecrate this house unto God. Why? Because when you give God a place where his glory can dwell, then you better get ready. His presence is going to manifest. And even if something is sick, even if something is dying, even if something's been dead, not one day, 2 days, 3 days, but 4 days, when Jesus Christ himself comes and fills the very temple where his glory dwells, you're going to see a miracle. You're going to see a sign. You're going to see a wonder. You're going to see the glory of God, but you got to believe. If you believe it, give them praise and give them glory. Hallelujah. So what's happening here? This is Hanukkah all over again. But if you go back to Hanukkah, what happened in Hanukkah is that after they did all that hard work, then they wanted to light the menorah, the candle, that has 8 candles on it, with the one in the middle sticking up, which is called the shamash, which I love, because shamash is just like shama. Shamash means the helper, and shama means the Lord is present. Why? To help. Amen. So here's what's happening, is that they have oil only for one night. So they light the candle saying, we only have enough oil for one night. And they can't get the next supply for the oil in the temple until another week. So they light it saying, God, we're trusting in you. Night one comes and night one goes, but the candle's still lit. Night two comes, night two goes, but the candles are still lit. Night three comes, night three goes, but the candles are still lit. Night four comes, but night four goes. The candles are still lit. Fifth night, sixth night, seventh night, eighth night, until finally the next supply of oil came, and then they continued with the next batch of oil. In the Old Testament, oil represented the Holy Spirit. Oil represented the presence of God. Oil represented God responding to his people. Come on, somebody. The Lord was saying, is that when you get things right in your life, when you get things right with God, and you make sure He's the only one, there's no room for another, and you believe in Him and who He is and how He is, then you better get ready, because you do your part, and what you can't do, He'll take care of doing for you. He'll take you past your limitations. He'll take you past your boundaries. He'll take you past your limit. He'll take you past your ceiling, and He'll move you into the miraculous. He'll move you, come on, into the wonderful. He'll move you into the supernatural. He'll move you into the glory as His glory moves into you. If you believe it, give Him praise and give Him glory.
Yeah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
So what happened in John chapter 10? Jesus says, I'm going to go celebrate Hanukkah. I'm going to continue to dedicate my life to Jesus. I'm going to continue to dedicate my life to Jehovah. I'm going to continue to dedicate my life to the Word. I'm going to continue to dedicate my life to the divine. But when he does, what happens? He's faced with idolatry. People don't believe in him. They believe in others. People are questioning him, not placing their faith in him. And then they say, prove it to us. And I just love Jesus. Because he says, listen, I'm a witness and my dad's a witness.
That's right.
And as long as two witnesses are present, so let a thing be established. But he says, but if you're not going to believe me and my word, believe my works. And he had already done all these miracles. But he says, okay, you want to see another one? Come with me to Bethany. Come on, somebody. Can you give me 7 more minutes and we're going to come to this altar? He says, come on. Why? Because when chapter 10 ends, what ends up happening? We go into chapter 11. And when we go into chapter 11, I don't have time to read it. You have to read it on your own. You read the story that he went to Bethany. Somebody say Bethany.
Bethany.
And when he went to Bethany, he went to the area. He was going towards Bethany, the area where Lazarus. Somebody say Lazarus.
Lazarus.
He's a friend of his who he loved. He had been really sick. And this Lazarus had two sisters, Martha and Mary. Somebody say Martha and Mary.
Martha and Mary.
And what's interesting is that Lazarus was sick. And Jesus himself says that this Mary, watch this, sister of Lazarus, was the same Mary who took fragrant oil and poured it on the feet of Jesus and washed his feet with her hair. And so the story goes that as he's getting sick, Lazarus is, then he dies. And when he dies, it doesn't make sense because Jesus says, hold up, we're going to wait another 2 days. And then, finally, on the fourth day, he says, okay, now it's time to go. What was happening? Well, there was possibly two different things happening. The first thing, understand, Jesus had been celebrating Hanukkah. So he was celebrating dedication, consecration for 8 days, number one. Number two, the Jewish tradition and experience at times was when somebody died, the soul of that person might leave their body but come back within the same day they died. Sometimes even up to 2 days, sometimes even up to 3 days. Jesus says, oh, no, there's going to be no chance for coincidence. This is not going to be a coincidence. This is going to be a God incident. Come on, somebody.
Yeah.
And he said, we're going to wait on purpose. One, because we're going to fully celebrate the festival of dedications. Two, because we want to make sure that there is no one else who gets the glory. No one else, no idolatry here. There's only going to be room to give God the glory, to give Jesus the glory, to give Jesus the praise. Come on, somebody.
Yeah.
And he says, I'm going to show you yet another work. And when he gets to Lazarus, and we read it, when he gets to the tomb, then he says, all right, the whole issue here is if you will believe, you will see. see the glory of God.
Amen.
Now, if you remember, I had you repeating the word believe like, I don't know, 10 times in John chapter 10, because that was the issue. The people were not believing. They were not believing. They were not believing. They were not believing. They were not believing. And because what you don't believe in, you don't dedicate yourself to. What you don't believe in, you don't consecrate yourself towards. What you don't believe in, you're not willing to go all in on. Come on, somebody. But Jesus was saying, I just need somebody who's willing to believe. Because if you believe, if you consecrate, if you dedicate, come on, if you celebrate the goodness of the Lord, then you will see the glory of God in your life. Hallelujah. I got 3 more minutes and we're coming to the altar. What are we talking about? You have to understand that when Jesus did many of his miracles, if not the majority of his miracles on earth, even though he's God in the flesh form and he could do it all by himself, he chose to partner with people. He would say, your faith has made you whole. He would say, go, your servant shall be well. And the person took him at his word. And they left and discovered that at the very time he said the word and they believed the word, the servant was healed.
Amen.
So Jesus is saying, I just need one to believe. I just need a believer. But understand this, a believer not in accepting the mere existence of God, but a believer who adores the very presence of God. See, there's a lot of people that just accept the existence of God, but they don't adore the presence of God. Come on, somebody. And so even in John 10, the people believed or had an acceptance that there was going to be a Messiah coming. But when he came, they did not adore him. So he says, I've got to find a real believer. Come on, somebody. He didn't say, I got to find a believer. He said, I got to find a believer. Young people, you just woke up. Okay. He said, and there were two sisters that he could have partnered with. One was named Martha and the other one's Mary. Somebody say Martha.
Martha.
Somebody say Mary.
Mary.
Is there anybody here named Martha? Good. Is there anybody here named Mary? Good. Nobody will get offended. Because you have to understand, watch this, that when Jesus is going from Jerusalem, which is the city of God, the city of peace, the city of David, the city of the beloved, and he's crossing over to the Jordan where John the Baptist had baptized him, that was the place where heaven had opened, where the Spirit of God came down, where the Father said, this is my Son, whom I love, with him I am well pleased, and when he believed on him there. Now he's going towards Bethany, but a lot of people, anybody named Bethany? Good. Bethany, although that's a beautiful name, did you know that Bethany means miserable or misery? There are a lot of people that live in Bethany. Their city is just not called Bethany. Their street's not called Bethany. Their house wasn't made by Bethany Custom Homes. But they live in a constant state and condition of misery and of miserable. Why? Because they did everything they could, but it wasn't enough. They did it in their strength. They did it in their might. They were trying to keep that sick thing alive. They were trying to keep that sick marriage alive, that sick home alive, that sick family alive. And guys, young people, I don't mean sick like good. I mean sick like bad. You'll get it on the way out. And they couldn't to no avail. And they're living in this Bethany. They're living in this misery. They're living in this miserable. But don't you thank God that he who is not misery, he who is not miserable, he who is miracle, come on, he who is miraculous is coming to your Bethany during these days of Hanukkah. Friend, we're in night 4. We're at the midway point. We're at the halftime, so to speak. And I'm just daring to believe that the same God who did the miraculous in 165 BC is the same God who did the miraculous in John chapter 10 and 11. He's the same God who can do the miraculous right here in 2015. If you believe it, give God praise. Close. He comes, and before he ever gets to the tomb, he has to have an encounter with two sisters. The first one is Martha. Martha, her name means ladylike. Isn't that a nice name? Ladylike, señora, señorita. You know what Mary's name means? Now, if you didn't raise your hand earlier to say your name is Mary, please don't raise it now. Mary means rebellious.
Wow.
You don't believe me? Google it. You find it. And just by the names, we would think, well, definitely then if Jesus needed somebody to partner with in faith, it certainly wasn't Mrs. Rebellious. It had to be Mrs. Ladylike.
Come on.
Are you with me? But see, that's how the human mind thinks, but that's not how God's heart moves. And so what happens is that Martha, when she finds out Jesus is coming, she doesn't even wait for Jesus to get to Bethany, to her house. She runs out to meet him while he's on his way, and she gets to him, and she says, if you had only been here, my brother would not have died. And Jesus responds and says, oh, Martha, I am going to resurrect your brother. And instead of her saying, hallelujah, thank you, Jesus. Lord, you're worthy of all the glory and all the honor and the praise. It makes me want to shout. She don't do that. She says, oh, Lord, I know he's going to be resurrected in the resurrection in the last days.
That's right. Yeah.
And Jesus said, what you talking about, Willis? I mean, Martha? I am the resurrection. I am the life. He who believes in me shall live even though he may die. Do you believe this? And she said, instead of saying, yes, Lord, I knew you the resurrection. I knew you the life. Now hurry up and resurrect my brother. She didn't say that. She said, I know you are the Messiah. The Christ, the Son of the living God. And he says, are you done yet? Are you done? Because after that, he's like, she runs to her sister. She says, hey, the master is calling for you. Now, when she comes to him, she's sitting down. Bible says she rose up quickly and she went to the very same place where her sister had encountered Jesus. And she says the very same thing. And she says, watch this. If you had only been here, my brother would not have died. But before I go any further and we close, you have to understand this. Why is this important? Because when Martha comes back to Mary, Mary is called by Jesus, but Jesus never called Martha.
Mm.
Why didn't Jesus ever call Martha? Why did he call Mrs. Rebellious? Oh, there was a reason. Because she was called rebellious. Meaning she had a past.
Yeah.
Meaning she had issues. Meaning she wasn't perfect. Meaning she had missed the mark. But there's something else that we sometimes forget. It's found in Luke chapter 10. You can just reference it, 38 through 42. Jesus comes to their house at another point in time earlier than this. And when he comes, Martha lets him in. But as soon as Martha lets him in, she gets distracted by everything in the house. And she starts losing her focus and getting overwhelmed. But Mary goes to Jesus and she sits at his feet and she listens to him and she just believes everything he has to say. What was happening here is that Jesus was saying, I don't need somebody who just merely accepts my existence. I need someone who adores my presence. If I can find someone who adores my presence, then I can find someone to manifest my presence over. And so when she comes, when she runs to Jesus, she was sitting down. But when she gets to him, she will sit down again. Why? Because this is the place not just of acceptance of his existence. This is a place of the adoration of his presence.
Amen.
And he was moved in his heart, the scripture says. And he says, where is he? He never asked Martha, where is he? But he asked so-called rebellious girl, where is he? She says, come, and he goes with her to the tomb. And when she shows up, because she is an adorer, because she is a true believer, because she is a worshiper, because she, watch this, takes the oil she has, the only oil she has, and pours it out, just like it happened in Hanukkah. The only oil they had, they poured it out. Now Jesus says, your worship in spirit and in truth has moved me, and I'm moved to move for your behalf. I'm moved to do a miracle. I'm moved to bring forth glory. I'm moved to bring forth the supernatural. I'm moved to bring forth something wonderful for you. I know you've given me the only thing you had. I know you've got nothing else. I know you have emptied yourself out, but now this is where I pour myself in. Take me to the tomb. And he says, remove that stone.
Come on. Hallelujah.
And Mary stays doing Jesus.
Come on.
Martha says, oh, no, no, whatever. By this time, he stank. Why? Because on day four, a dead body begins to decompose.
Right.
And he looks at her and says, get rid of your stinking thinking. He says, Father, I thank you. You believe me. You hear me. Mary, she believes me. Now he goes, Lazarus, come forth. And Lazarus was more than just a name. Listen closely. Lazarus means assistance from God. You know what he was doing? When there is somebody on planet Earth that understands consecration, when there's somebody on planet Earth that understands dedication, when there's somebody on planet Earth that understands giving it all until you have nothing else to give, when there's somebody on planet Earth that is a true adorer of his presence, then he says, get ready. Heaven is about to open. Heaven's about to come down. Glory is about to intervene. And even what's dead is about to come back to life. And even what's bound is about to be let loose. And even what seemed to be destroyed is going to have a greater destiny for your life. I'm here to encourage you tonight that no matter what you've been sick, no matter what has been dead, no matter what you have lost, as long as you were determined to be like a Mary and not like a Martha and not have head knowledge of theology, but have a heart knowing of Jesus Christ and who he is, then you are about to see the glory of God in your life. These are the days of the supernatural. These are the days of the miraculous. These are the days of his wonderful. This is the time for you to see the glory of God in your life. If you believe it, would you put your hands together? Would you stand up with me? Would you give God a shout of praise? Somebody give him glory. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.